This was my first road trip to the Newark Showground on Saturday the 4th of March to experience the Hammerhead Wargame Show. Previous years the show had been split over two buildings, but this year the whole event was taking place under one roof inside the well-equipped George Stephenson Exhibition Hall. With loads of free parking on site, I arrived early as the queue was starting to form, and as a bonus, the doors opened 10 minutes early to start getting the gamers into the show without delay. Inside the hall, there were 50 gaming tables on display, along with a host of traders, a DBA competition, Wargames Illustrated was running a painting competition, and there were bargains to be had at the popular bring and buy sale, plus a bistro café for refreshments. The first table that caught my eye was the Target Express, presented by the Leeds Wargaming Club. BattleTech Alpha Strike rules were being used for the game to allow participants to pilot battle mechs, bristling with weapons and armour, with a custom scenario involving a train heist set during the Fedcom Civil War.
Hi, I'm Andrew, I'm from Leeds Wargames Club. We're here at Hammerhead today and I'm putting on a game of BattleTech using the Alpha Strike rules. It's based on a number of films, The Italian Job, Kelly's Heroes, so basically all the terrain is now 3D printed, including I've now discovered that I really like printing out transfers, and the basic is they have to stop a train and then capture the person inside.
As mentioned, the scenario involved a train heist to kidnap a line operative. This was to be performed by three minis painted red, white and blue. I'm sure that sounds familiar. Anyway, the terrain was exceptional and really brought the game to life. I wonder if the Federated Sun pilots blew the bloody doors off the train. Next up was the Leeds Night Owls, demonstrating an epic Horus Heresy game set in the grimdark future of the Warhammer 40k world. This scale allows vast armies to do battles on an epic scale, with the gaming board depicting an assault on the Imperial Palace. As huge god machines of the Adeptus Titanicus could be seen striding across the battlefield, banners fluttering as they moved purposefully over the ruins in front of the Imperial Palace. The sound of gunfire could be heard all over the city as sirens wailed, while high above you could imagine yourself in a Thunderhawk gunship flying over this scene of devastation. There were numerous traders at the show, but one of my personal favourites has to be Warlord Games, who produced Bolt Action, Hail Caesar, Blood Red Skies and Cruel Seas, to name but a few. Warlord Games were showcasing their epic scale black powder game, the Waterloo Campaign, which allows players to field troops from Napoleon's French army and coalition forces led by the Duke of Wellington and Marshal Blücher. British, Scots and Prussians fought side by side in an effort to defeat Napoleon's superior army. Waterloo is such an iconic battle, and seeing these epic scale troops in their various colours and formations move around the battlefield in an attempt to outmaneuver each other in order to gain the upper hand is simply amazing. At the moment, the famous farmhouse, the Hyacinth, is free with the starter sets, which adds a beautiful piece of scenery to the battlefield that your forces can interact with. The gaming table nicely displayed the armies found in the starter sets, from Wellington's British Army, Blücher's Prussians, and Bonaparte's French. There is an awful lot of troops contained inside each box, making these great value for money. Being a Judge Dredd fan, I was eager to see the latest releases. Although not on the sales rack, they did have a complete Block War pre-release boxes displayed on the counter. I couldn't find a Judge Dredd gaming table at the show, but I did manage to locate a novel game of Daleks vs. Dredd, hosted by the Forest Outlaws. Using squad level rules based on bolt action, this allowed quick gameplay, moving groups of models rather than controlling individual figures as in the Judge Dredd game. This was an interesting concept that I may just have to try myself. Space Marines vs. Dredd, now there's an idea. Seeing a herd of Daleks, not sure if that's the correct terminology, glide towards the judges of Mega City 1 looks cinematically great. Not sure if the judges could select different rounds for their lawgivers, but I'm sure they would give these tin cans a run for their money. I particularly like the 3D printed Cursed Earth Land Raider. That would certainly squash a few Daleks under its tracks. I had seen What a Cowboy demonstrated by the Harrogate Wargames Club at a previous show, but this time they were using the rules to play a game of rival gangs in the Roaring Twenties, as opposed to cowboys. Using the skirmish rules set by the Two Fat Lardies, you take on the role of hitmen, enforcers and shootists. In this scenario, you need to work together in order to raid the bank of Eagle Creek. The scenery plays an important role in the game as you move in and out of cover, trying to overcome your opponents. Just like What a Tanker, gamers can become quite animated in this fun and not to be taken too seriously skirmish game. With similar game mechanics, you can shoot wildly hoping to hit something, or take that well-aimed shot to remove a rival gang member. And remember, only one of you can walk away with the prize. Being a fan of Zombicide by Cool Mini or not, Zombie Glory, hosted by the Glory Boys, takes surviving the zombie apocalypse to another level. As you clamber from the wreckage of a crashed plane with your fellow survivors, the radio crackles to life, telling you that the whole area is about to be firebombed by the military, and you must make your way to a safe zone. But there just ain't enough safe zones for everyone.
Hello there, I'm Dave Marks, this is Zombie Glory. It's a game that I made up especially to bring around to shows. It's not commercially available. It's a quick bang and crash game, survival, it's just basically a race. You've got to get from the centre of the bomb to any one of the safe zones while avoiding the treachery of other players and the killing of the other zombies. Chuck load of dice, it's very easy to pick up. It's a combination of cards, activation cards, and that's about it.
As the race for survival begins, it's kill or be killed, as zombies and your fellow survivors all become threats. What makes this game is the scenery. Everywhere you look, there are details that you missed the first time round. From the crash site to the bombed out buildings, the attention to detail is amazing, with humorous posters and signage on display as the dead continue to rise up from the graveyard. Taking a break from the wargaming tables, it was time to visit the ever so popular Bring and Buy area, which was full of some great bargains, from complete games, accessories, unused model kits, and painted figures that could be put straight on your gaming table when you got home. Next to this was the Wargames Illustrated painting competition. I was pleasantly surprised by the volume and standard of entries on display. I'm sure a lot of these models will appear in the magazine at a later date, along with the results. Here are a few of my favourites.
Okay.
Always a popular participation game is Wings of Glory, hosted by the Wings of Glory Aerodrome Forum, in which you get to pilot a World War I plane in a game of aerial combat. The rules use a simple card-based movement system, where you all plan your manoeuvres, then execute them to see who gets guns on their opponents. This game certainly scales, as I've seen groups going into double figures all playing this game together. Another advantage of this game is that all the rules, counters, and even pre-painted planes come in the box ready to play. Additional planes with different flight characteristics can be added, so the sky's the limit on what you can play. The combat is very cinematic as these biplanes and triplanes fight for dominance over the battlefield, and even bombing missions on ground targets can be incorporated into the game. Dark Age Kingdoms is a skirmish game produced by the Wargame Shop. Set in the Dark Ages, it can be used with any figures you may have from other similar games. There are two rule sets, the Warband Edition, containing the basic rules, that can be played from 6 to 24 figures, and the Noble Hardback Edition, with advanced rules and taking the gameplay up to 60 figures in total.
Hi, I'm Martin Browley from Wargame Shop. This is a new set of rules that we've developed. It's called Dark Age Kingdoms, used for 25mm Dark Age rules, figures, basically using a simple system of action and reaction. So if somebody makes an attack, the defender gets to block or parry or dodge away from the attack. Uses different sets of class figures through from Tenderfoot, and you're finishing off with Veteran. Have a play, it's on our website, www.wargameshop.uk.
As the rule set uses a hex-based system, your regular models on round bases can be placed in adapters for the purpose of this game. This is important as it determines your front, side and rear facing, with shield facings edged in red, weapons in blue and rear black. It's important on how you face your opponent, as this will affect the outcome of your combat. An interesting alternative to games like Saga and Line Rampant. Webbed Feet, or Descent Snorkel would have helped, to give it its proper title, was a demonstration game from a very British civil forum. In this game, you took charge of a small unit of men and vehicles, with the aim of capturing objectives using a platoon level rule set entitled Went the Day Well. The game is fought over a long river section, and you can probably guess your objectives are on the other side. Here are a few of the platoons ready for participants to take to the board and command. Each one has three transports, and these are needed to carry your objectives, so you'd best look after them. Players participating in the game are using every possible method to get to the other side of the river and secure their objectives. Bridges become key, and boats are useful for incursions across the river. However, any movement across that river and you instantly become a target. A group of British soldiers can be seen securing their objective, represented by barrels, and preparing to carry them to safety in two of their allocated transports. In Whose Name We Dare Not Speak is a fantasy game above and below a fantasy medieval town, hosted by the Chesterfield Open Gaming Society. This massive game of fantasy-themed bounty hunting, played on an 18-foot by 4-foot table, allows players to take control of a pair of hunters, a veteran and a rookie, in a quest to eliminate as many monsters and other villains as possible, using a set of homegrown rules. Gameplay is varied, as it is played in different areas across the board, including a dockyard, a city, fortifications, countryside mine and dungeon. The scenery is simply stunning, with many of the buildings coming apart, so gameplay can continue inside a lot of the structures. There is something for everyone. I think I'd take my hunters to the top of the tower and just watch the fun and fall below. Ding Dong, presented by the Lost Ark Wargamers, is set in June 1940 with fear of German paratroopers landing in southern England. Using bolt-action rules, you have to defend the village from the Germans. But watch out, as there are fifth columnists sabotaging the church bells used to warn the home guard of invaders. This is a light-hearted take on defending a village from German occupation. The church tower is manned by the home guard with a machine gun, but will only open fire if they are alerted by the scouts or the sound of gunfire. Do you recognise the people outside the pub? Are they villagers or saboteurs sent to prepare the way for the German paratroopers? If all else fails, I'd collect some vegetables from the allotment and then go inside for a cup of tea. G Patrol by Onchless Wargames delivered an interesting 12mm World War II participation game called Operation Caravan, set in Libya in 1942. Using their own rule set, the game involved a long-range desert group split into two forces, each controlled by a participant. There are a number of objectives to complete in the mission, but as always, as mayhem ensues, these can often be forgotten. Using 12mm scale, a large playing area can be presented on a physically small board, with beautifully made buildings moulded into the scenery. This gives the long-range desert group, consisting of two Jeeps, three Chevys, and a Chevy with a 20mm Beretta autocannon, something to explore. As the flag on the tower waves in the breeze, will the participants remember this is a 30-minute objective-based game? Saving my favourite gaming table till last, UFO Final Conflict by Wheelords just took me back to my childhood, watching this classic 1970s British science fiction television series. With spaceship interceptors, tanks and submarines defending the Earth against alien invasion, what's not to like? With the rule set readily available in Miniature Wargames magazine, you just need some models and the imagination of its creator, Gerry Anderson.
Hi, my name's John Treadaway. The club is the Wearlords. I'm also the editor of Miniature Wargames magazine. We're producing a game here with three sections of a game based on a TV series made in the end of the 1960s, early 1970s, called UFO, Aliens Attacking the Earth. And it's quite an interesting game. We've got interception in space, interceptors with the sea, and UFOs landing on the Earth and trying to do what aliens do, which is stealing people's body parts, which is quite unpleasant in a very adult kind of way. And all of this is modelled in different ways with different game systems. Like I said, the rules have all been available in Miniature Wargames over the last few years.
The majority of the models seen on this table come pre-painted from a Japanese company called Konami. The interceptor model is great, as is the one of Skydiver, a submarine that also had a fighter jet that could be launched into the sky while submerged. The Shadow Mobile, complemented by some simple 50mm figures representing the Shadow Agents and Aliens, are all that is needed to surround the crashed UFO. Hammerhead was great, well worth a visit, and I've only shown you some of what's on display here. Anyway, with lots more to see, I'm off now. But if you enjoyed this video, why not leave a comment, and don't forget to like and subscribe to the channel if you wish to see similar content from the Retro Attic Man Cave. Oh, I almost forgot to mention, I managed to get a new Panther Tank themed craft mat for my hobby table in the attic, along with a set of the Line Rampant rules. I also met this little chap, who informed me that I could have brought my dog along to the show. Ah well, maybe next time. Cheers!